Lefteris and his project Rotki, which is finally shortened from Rotkehlchen, the German word for red robin. And this is a product that we're using here at Paralelopolis to manage the assets that that we have in crypto. Provides a transparent, private way to manage your portfolio, and is an open source project that also has a Gitcoin grant and contributors. And looking forward to see this growing in the space. Take it away, Lefteris.
All right, I'm happy to be here. It's my first virtual conference, so yeah, let's see how it goes. I'll just share my screen and show you a presentation about what Rotki is. Welcome. I will talk to you about Rotki, the portfolio tracker that respects your privacy. For those of you who don't know me, even though Michael gave an intro, my name is Lefteris. I just, you know, I like building stuff. So I've been Ethereum since 2014. I worked on the Solidity language compiler, the C++ client for Ethereum, which is no longer used, and for the ETHAS algorithm. Later, I worked for Slockit and built the DAO with Christoph. And then, sorry about that. We cleaned it up, let's say. I worked for a long time for the Raiden network. And at the same time, and especially now, I'm focusing a lot more on Rotki, which is what this talk is about. So the talk is going to be quite similar to the ETHIC talk that I gave in Paris in the beginning of last month. So if you have seen that, maybe there is not too much new stuff for you, except for some changes in the future direction. I will originally start about explaining why this whole thing is being made, something that I call the crypto accounting paradox. I'll later explain how Rotki addresses this, then a presentation of its features, then show the current roadmap and future work, and close with a call to action. So the crypto accounting paradox. Many of us have used crypto for years. So this is a situation that many times you probably have encountered. So you have crypto in many accounts, in many blockchains. So many Bitcoin accounts, many Ethereum accounts. You've probably traded in more than one exchange. Maybe you did a gig and someone paid you in crypto. And God forbid, for the last year or so, maybe you played with decentralized finance. And now you either have to just find where is what, or even worse, you may have to pay taxes on some of it. So what do you do? Same thing I did 2 years ago. I just started Googling, what can I do? I wanted portfolio trackers and accounting tools for crypto. You get a list similar to this. This list has a big problem, which is everything in there is a centralized cloud application, which takes all of your financial data. Rotki is also there. There is another called the Warden, which I don't know if it's still being continued though. So point being that there aren't really any open source tools apart or weren't back then that could allow for accounting. So what is wrong with software as a service? Software as a service is not bad per se, but it has some problems, especially when it comes with financial data. So I will go through these problems one by one in the next slide. The problem of maintainability. So essentially, closed source lives and dies with the company that creates them, while open source, as they say, is forever. If I don't know, like I die from coronavirus tomorrow or something, God forbid, then someone else can pick it up. Or in the worst case, the last version of Rotki is already in GitHub. Everybody can download it and use it. Closed source has the problem that you cannot really trust what it does. Especially for crypto accounting, there are many edge cases like Some tokens have different names in some exchanges and different in others. You cannot really be sure that your accounting tool does what you think it does. And we've seen how software claim to do things, like now with Zoom and end-to-end encryption, and then it turns out that they were lying. I would say don't trust, but verify. And the only way to verify is by checking the source code. So another big problem is the lack of data ownership. So your data is not owned by you when you're using a centralized service. If it at some point goes out of business, your data disappears with it. And this is not like the fear-mongering. This has happened and very recently, and especially for crypto accounting. So both Amin from SparkChain and Friederike from Gnosis, they were using some kind of centralized software as a service accounting tool. And well, it went out of business and all of their data were lost. So, you know, you spent months putting in all your data, making the connections between the accounts, having it all nice and working for you. And then suddenly the business ceases to exist and your data just poof, they disappear. And this is the mother load. So I'm very sensitive to privacy, and this is why I started Rotki in the first place. So you don't have privacy. You put your most financial data, your most sensitive data, all gathered in a juicy honeypot. So you give your data to a third party, and this is very sensitive data, the financial data, so how much you own and what you have done. What they can do is they can sell it to the highest bidder if you're the really buddies. Maybe they use it for their own purposes. Accidents happen. Maybe some employee has a bad day and makes a mistake, and then a leak happens. Or hackers target that particular accounting tool that's storing your data. I have had, you know, even cypherpunks and, you know, crypto guys say that, you know, this is what happened to me. It's fine. It's okay. They just shrug it off. But we have seen that basically hacks happen and data leaks also happen. And quite often, they happen all the time. So I do not think that it is really a question of if, but when the data breach will happen. Some parties, I don't know, like maybe criminals or government agencies would have everything you own, when and where, your total net worth, every action that you have performed. And worst part is that you would also have your address, since most of these tools require you to pay and you would need to have an invoice. And depending on your type of payment, they could have your address. So let's say a criminal has a list with the most rich people around him, and he can just start kidnapping. And hacks do happen. I'm not fear-mongering, because here is like this Blocks.io. It was one of the big accounting tools that I'm not sure if they still exist in crypto. And they had their website hacked back in July 17. So how can we get out of this mess, right? Why am I saying all this? If you get anything out of this talk, even if you do not use Rotki, even if you just never download the software, just please do not put your sensitive financial data anywhere online. There are levels of privacy that you guys, that people should respect. Like, okay, maybe your vacation photos, if they leak, they're not that important or whatever, but your financial transactions are probably one of the most sensitive data that you have. So please do not just blindly put stuff like that online. So how can Rotki help? So what we do at Rotki is that we are an open source portfolio tracker, an accounting tool that respects your privacy. This is our whole USP, like the unique selling point, let's say. This is how it looks like. This is a screenshot from one of the recent versions. You have your dashboard with some how much you have in a particular exchange, how much you have in your bank, then a dashboard of the balances here. It's not a browser app. Still, many people actually think and ask me for a URL. you just download it. It's a very kind of old school app. You can find it for Windows. We have binaries for Windows, Linux, and OS X. And we store your data locally. This is basically how you can be sure that you don't leak your data. You just have it saved locally and encrypted. Thanks to SQL Cipher, we have strong encryption guarantees. We are open source. We have a GitHub repo, so you can actually see that what I'm saying is true. So don't just trust that I trust me when I say that it's encrypted. You should go or ask someone who knows how to check the code and see that, yes, indeed, this application does encrypt the data locally. And it will be available in perpetuity because, yeah, it's in GitHub. And I mean, many people have also cloned the repo. So a small rundown of the features. We have a dashboard in the beginning that shows all of your assets. So how much of this asset you have, what is the equivalent value in fiat. So this particular fiat is euro here, but it can be US dollars, Korean won, or whatever you want. And the percentage that this represents of the total net value. You can also manually add fiat balances. I haven't found a way to pull data from traditional banks, unfortunately, so you have to do some manual work here. Most of the trades are pulled automatically from the blockchain or from the exchanges, but for the trades that we cannot find, you can manually add them. We have a particular pane in the UI. As I said, automatically importing data from exchanges is supported. You just add an API key and Rottkey will do the rest. It will pull all of the data, your balances and your trades, and save them locally. We support Kraken, Binance, BitMEX, Bittrex, Coinbase, Coinbase Pro, Gemini, and one more I'm missing. Poloniex. You can also, as I said, fetch data from the blockchain. We only support Ethereum and Bitcoin for now. For the others, you would have to input data manually. The best way to use it is if you have your own node. So if you have an Ethereum node locally, it will pull data from there, or a Bitcoin node. But if you don't, then we query third-party sites like Etherscan, Aleph.io, or MyCrypto soon. Other features that we have is like you can add tags. So you can create a new tag. Say this guy wants to have a specific tag for accounts that are private that nobody knows about, so that he doesn't make a mistake by posting it somewhere where people can associate it with his name. You can, you know, customize it, like put colors, etc. And you can also add labels to addresses. So like call it his first miner or whatever. And then in your dashboard, you will see the addresses with the names and with the tags. And later, you can also actually filter by tags. So you can see all of your private addresses and combine the filters. We also support DeFi, not much yet. So we support the MakerDAO DSR, the DAI savings rate, and we want to support more. The DSR looks like this. You have your DSR page that shows you how much is the percentage of the current yearly return, how much DAI you have locked, and how much DAI you have earned so far. And also a history of all the transactions. You can also, if you have a premium account, which is how we are funding the project or attempting to, you can also see this history in the tax report. And talking about tax report, we allow you to export all of your profit loss as a statement that you can later use with your local tax office if you want to do a tax report. You don't have to because people were associating like Rottkey with being like a tax reporting tool. That's just not it. It's mostly portfolio tracking. You don't have to do a tax report if you don't want to. And you get a list of all of the actions that you have done. you can export this. This tends to be huge. For example, this is just test data, but it has like 8,100 trades and other stuff like asset movements and even the transaction gas costs are taking into account. And the CSV, you can put it into a spreadsheet and give it to your accountant. This is how I have done my taxes for crypto for the past 3 years. For premium users, we also have analytics. So graphs like this, how your net value has advanced over time, or something really interesting, how the value of an asset and its amount has progressed over time. So this is the Bitcoin of this user. And he has, I don't know, at the peak in 2017, he has 0.26 Bitcoin. No, sorry, 0.26, what is this? Yes, Bitcoin, and this is the asset value in dollars. So the brown line is how much Bitcoin he has. So he sells at the top and then slowly buys at, as it falls, and then as it falls more, he buys more. So you can have, with premium, you can have such graphs which can give you insights into how you have managed your assets. More graphs like this, you can see the distribution of your net value over location. So how much of your money is in Kraken, in Poloniex, in Bittrex, in your bank, etc. Or more interesting, how much of your total net worth is in Monero, in Bitcoin, Zcash, etc., depending on what assets you are tracking in Rootkit. What's coming in the future is support for more exchanges. People are asking to include their favorite exchange. We are just two main developers right now, so it's not really fast to react to feature requests. But if you're a paying premium subscriber, we prioritize it. That's how we also got Coinbase Pro and Gemini into the app. We will add more DeFi support, so the MakerDAO stuff, Compound, Uniswap, and Kyber, decentralized exchanges. And for the Gitcoin grant guys, we will also have a nice report if you own a grant. We also want Rootkit to become the place to do for to go for accounting. So even for traditional financial accounting, like, I don't know, stocks, bonds, real estate, ETFs, even a daily expense tracker. And for the more close future, and like probably the coolest thing that we are planning in the short-term future is Dappnode. If you don't know what Dappnode is, it's a small machine that you can just buy, and it runs, it's just there to run an Ethereum node, a Bitcoin node, or other crypto nodes. So Rootkit actually has its own backend, and it can be separated from the UI. So it would be running along with the Ethereum node in the same small machine. And then you as a user would just connect to Rootkit via user interface from your desktop or from your mobile phone in the same local area network. So this way you could have all of your data safely in your dApp node, and you could just take it from your mobile phone. And this is something that is not going to take too much time, we hope. And for the more long-term future, and this goes to making Rootkit a sustainable business, we would be running a Rootkit instance remotely for you by us. The code would be the same and the same privacy guarantees. But this would be accessible anywhere, and you could even access it from your mobile phone. Maybe also a mobile app, but we are not sure. We have to see how things progress, trying to find ways to make this into a sustainable business. So that's mostly it. We'll just close with some call to action and some links. So please use Rootkit. Most of us need some kind of crypto portfolio tracking or accounting if you use crypto. So please use it daily and spread the word about it. Like tell your friends, maybe tweet about it. Generally, this kind of software really spread by word of mouth. If you have a GitHub account, starting our GitHub repo would really help, because we get more open source contributors when it has more stars. And you can follow us in Twitter. I will post links later in the chat. For these links also. So you can join our Discord or our Telegram and ask questions, or if you want to contribute, it's open source. That's the place to actually go, especially the Discord. Contributing code would be the best thing. If you are interested in, if you know Python or TypeScript, Vue.js or Electron/Node.js, then please come, because we have a few open source contributors, but the two main developers is are me and my buddy Kelsos. So it would be really nice if we had more frequent contributors to the project. As many other projects have also mentioned, there is this Gitcoin CLR matching round going on right now. I will include a link later in the chat. So open source software really needs help in funding, and right now $1 worth of donation would be matched by up to 100. So if you are interested, it would be pretty cool if you could give a hand into this grant. And for people who are into crypto and accounting, generally getting a premium subscription would really help us, because that's how we plan to monetize the project in the future. And I have already described what the premium premium features are. So that's mostly it. I just would like to close with a quote from Snowden. So that today everybody's on the list, no matter how innocent. So systems of mass surveillance strive to record all people in all places and at all times. So the question is no longer, am I on the list, but it is, what is my rank on the list? So my plea to you is do not feed the list further, and do not put your sensitive financial data online. Use open source and local software like Rodkey.
Does anybody have any questions they'd like to ask Lefteris?
I have a question. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. Do you plan to include non-fungible tokens?
That's a good question. That's a very good question. We could. Actually, nobody has requested this feature at the moment. The thing is, if they would make sense, if you can, I mean, non-fungible, you can't really trade them. So maybe they don't have a value in the sense of accounting, but we could definitely include them since we are querying the blockchain anyway. But nobody has requested this feature. Technically, it's feasible.
You know what I'm interested in as a feature request? I have multiple accounts tied to my Ethereum addresses, like Threebox, Gitcoin, and other stuff that are all bind to different accounts, and I really need a tool to bring that all together. So, and balances and non-fungible tokens. So I would see the whole my whole assets in one place.
Yeah, so. I see. So NFT, so non-fungible. Yeah, we can definitely show it. Yeah, I mean, it will be more for the portfolio tracking, not the accounting part, because you just see what you have, like as NFTs. Yeah, that's an interesting feature request. Yeah.
If you have a feature request for a Gitcoin grant contribution.
Yeah. But you can also make an issue in GitHub so that we don't forget this. Do you have GitHub?
Yeah.
Okay, I will post some links now, and you can just basically visit and put an issue there about this.
Okay. By the way, very cool presentation and great app. And I like your name and logo very much. Oops.
Thanks. The logo is one of my favorite things. I specifically once asked someone, like, in this 99 Designs website, please, someone, can you make a Robin logo sitting on an petting on an abacus? And this was the result.
Wow, that's really cool result.
Yeah, I don't know how they do it. I tried to draw at some point, and yeah, it like a 3-year-old, it was the result, and I didn't keep it.
And calling it Rotki was a good choice. Not sure.
Yeah, I know. So many people, but basically, it's something that you realize after a few months of trying to actively market the project and tell them, yes, just Google Rod Kelhin. And then they're like, what? How do I write that? It's very difficult if you don't have a name that you can actually spell.
Yeah, Rotki drags attention easily.
Leftris, how many users, how many downloads? What's your community like? How many contributors? What are the numbers on all those things?
So the contributors you can see in GitHub, don't remember right now, but like for unique contributors, one commit, maybe we have around 30 contributors of, like, if you just count one commit as contribution. For downloads, the latest release has 200, I think. And maybe daily users, we have about, I don't know, a bit less than 100 people who seem to open it daily.
And how do you get those statistics about daily use?
It gives us statistics in the beginning. You can, opt out, but it's opt-in by default. Because as a local app, I'm not able to get any information about who runs it, and this is pretty bad. So we have, when you log in, there's a setting to opt out of giving statistics, but it gives us a statistic by default, which basically says which version you're running and what operating system you're on.
So the minimal amount of data that people are willing to give up, just so you know what your user numbers are, basically.
Yeah. Or else, basically, we wouldn't know who is using it. And I mean, it's very difficult to get data about which users are actually using it in OSX, which users are using it in Linux, in Windows. So we need this kind of data.
Yeah, it's the privacy application project dilemma.
I mean,
we went through this at Status. So when we were doing the beta releases of Status, and we decided when Jared announced it at DevCon in Prague that we were going off of Slack and using Status as our own, we're going to dog food with the application. And we basically signed off of all Google services, all tracking, and everything, and the only way that they had any sort of numbers were downloads, but in terms of active usage and things, the only way is user bug reports and stuff. And that was also by Status, an opt-in feature. All of those things were opt-in, but that's when you're in the privacy space working with transparency tools on blockchains, it's really a hard thing to get around as a developer of an application, to get that feedback.
Yeah, exactly. So I'm trying to not overdo. I mean, people were also telling me, like, they made issues about why don't I make it like to go querying everything through Tor or randomize all of the requests to external services. These are all extra privacy steps, but I would like to first have Rotki as like a super functional, as good as the current centralized services alternative, so that we can get more people. And then when we have also more users and more developers working on it, it will be much easier to make more, even more crazy privacy preserving stuff, like allow usage of Tor for the queries.
As an independent developer with a Gitcoin grant over a longer period of time, has that provided you with any significant level or insignificant level of funding that actually pays for the hours that you put into something like this? So degree is Rottki and intrinsically motivated, and what degree and extrinsically motivated, open source, common good, classic example. Where do you find yourself on that spectrum as somebody sitting at home and you know, building this project?
Yeah, that's a very, very good question, actually. I plan to write a blog about the two rounds that I have seen so far. Let's say that it has been good. The Gitcoin grant has been some help, but definitely not sustainable enough to actually even fund the salary of one and a half developer. There are two rounds, right? So one round is supposed to hold you for 3 months because they are supposed to happen every quarter. So the first round we got 4,000 DAI, that's $4,000. You don't pay one and a half developer for 3 months or even one developer for 3 months with this amount of money. But still, it's not nothing. It's not an insignificant amount. So it's kind of signal that the community wants this and wants to help us develop it. So kind of mixed feelings. It's like help, it's good, but not enough yet. But I don't think it can be enough because of the amount of money that goes into the main pot that funds all of the grants. I don't think it's possible with so many grants to actually have people fund themselves only through Gitcoin.
So let me ask you a follow-on question. To what degree, you think that the friction of having to have a Gitcoin account plays in contributing to Gitcoin grants? Do you think it would be easier if people didn't have to have a Gitcoin ID? If they could just contribute to a Gitcoin grant round with MetaMask or whatever without having to go through the process of participating in their platform?
Yeah, there was actually a Twitter discussion about this. It would be easier if they offered more authentication ways. Say, I don't know, like also Twitter or Reddit or I don't know. Like, the only reason why they have this GitHub and Gitcoin is so that they are Sybil attack resistant or trying to. But the problem with this is that no matter how many different authentication methods they use, everybody can have 2 Twitter accounts, 3 Twitter accounts, or 4 Twitter accounts, or 4 GitHub accounts. So you can cheat the system. The only real way to solve this would be to use some kind of decentralized identity that is not ready yet, or God forbid, actually use KYC.
Am I correct in remembering that you're actually one of the people that's paying attention to people that are trying to game the Gitcoin grants? I think I saw on a channel somewhere together with Scott that you were.
Yes, and I suspect there is one of the big Gitcoin grants that may be gaming it. They say that they have a huge following, but I don't know, man. At some point, it also becomes a question, how is that supposed to help open source if it's only about people who have a huge following? So, I don't know, a huge YouTube video channel or a huge Discord, a Telegram community, and you can ask all of them to go and help your grant. Then it kind of becomes a popularity contest instead of actual helping open source software.
Yeah. Nobody's cracked that nut. Thank you so much, Lefteris, for coming today and for everything that you do in the community, man.
My pleasure. It was really fun being here, and thank you for having me.